What legacy does the late President Benigno Aquino III leave? How will Filipinos remember him? Joining us now is political analyst Professor Edna Co. She is director of the UP Diliman Extension Program in Pampanga. Professor Co, nice to see you today. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to the program.
Yes, nice to see you, Carmina, again on such a mournful day.
I know, a very, very sad day. How has this profound loss affected you? Affecting you? Let's begin with that first.
Actually, the passing on of former President Pinoy came at a time when everybody seems to be thinking about governance. Actually, it's not because my field is governance, but I thought this is an occasion where we try to look back again. And what did this former president contribute to Philippine governance is something that comes to mind. So this is what I feel for now, reflect on Philippine governance. What did he contribute to it? Mm-hmm. And regardless of political choices and inclinations, I think we should be thankful for him to have served the country as president for 6 years.
Might you have any thoughts, Professor, about how this passing, how this profound loss might impact on the 2022 elections?
Well, actually, today, this death of the former president will make people come to think of what he did and also what we want of a leader. And this is, as I said, it comes at a timely moment when people are starting to think about 2022.
Mm. You know, we had former governor, now Congressman Joey Salceda, on the show just a few minutes ago. And, you know, basically everybody's saying the administration was far from being perfect. But when you look at the numbers don't lie. For example, when you talk about the education sector, the thousands of teachers hired, the many thousands of classrooms that were built, when you talk about the GDP, average inflation during his time, what are your thoughts about that?
Well, I will agree perfectly with Congressman Joey. There is no administration and there is no single leader who is perfect. Far from it, actually. And as one steps down, probably we say how bad and how good the administration was. But I will believe that if you look at it from different points of view and measures or metrics, one will realize that the time of Pinoy during his term as president brings to mind to me some of the essential questions about governance. Mm. And Carmina, to me, governance is not just strong government alone. It is governance is really how he tried to bring in private sector, the international groups and organizations and communities and citizens, ang mga ordinaryong mamamayan, at ang gobyerno. In other words, government is just one of the players. And if you look back at what he did, it is something like, to me, the buzzword now in governance is, what is 21st century governance? Mm-hmm. What is 21st century public administration? And this is it. We have the confluence of everyone pitching in to make a difference. And I thought, looking back, that's what he did. He brought in the private sector, let them contribute to the economy. And I think Congressman Joey gave all the data and the information on this. He was a socialist in a way because he tried to look at social programs, development of the four P's, even if this was not originally his program. Schools, oh my goodness, there were so many school buildings built during his time. So, I mean, healthcare, he probably suffered some criticisms on the SSS. But if you come to look at it now, thinking back, tama pala, kailangan kino-compute yung long term, no? Mm-mm. Because at the end of the day, you don't want your coffers to be totally bankrupt.
Yeah, we were talking about that with former spokesperson Edwin Lacerda as well earlier on today, and he did say that was one of the topics that they really had intense discussions over. Yeah. And because, you know, it has to be funded.
Yes.
It cannot remain unfunded.
And it cannot be drained because it has to have continuity. So here is a manager. This is the thinking of a manager who looks at it not from just about now, but what is it in the long term? And the investment, I think, was really on the long term, looking at social assistance, looking at healthcare, at education as well. That's really long term, but also bringing in everyone, all sectors on board. Kaya ang iniisip ko, nako, eto yung isang 21st century governance. Hindi na uso na gobyerno lang yung mag-steer, no? We cannot leave everything to government alone, eh. That's the 21st century theory of public administration. Ang tawag namin doon, networked governance. Everyone has to be on board. And I think this is one of the thoughts that come to my mind, no? When I look back at the 6 years of Pinoy. But on top of it, there are some siguro parang petty, but I thought, looking back, as I was asked to listen to the SONA during his time and comments on it, siya lang yung nakikita ko na bukod tangi, isang pangulo ng Pilipinas na in straight Pilipino, nagde-deliver ng kanyang public speeches in Pilipino. And mind you, it's in perfect, correct Filipino, having come from Ateneo and having been educated in that school, I think it's wonderful, it's refreshing to listen to a leader who would like to connect and to talk to people in the language, in the dialect that is closest to them. So sa akin, ito yon, isang, siya lang yung natatandaan ko na presidente na ganon, ano? And very, very straightforward. But at the end of the day, siguro tama yung term na servant leader. But at the end of the day, he emptied himself. When he stepped down, he really stepped down. And no shadow of him. No? So I think this is, when you are asked to serve, you serve the best you can. Despite the failings, despite the shortcomings, and despite the crisis that come your way.
But we have to understand also,
down, you're done.
I'm talking about the former president really stepping away from the shadows and being his own person. Because there was a point when he was uncomfortable at the beginning of, in the early days of his presidency. But when he stepped down, that was all him.
I think, he was himself throughout. I mean, that's my reading, no? A private person, a quiet person. He served in Congress, and in a sense, it's a public life, it's public service. But even more so when he served as president, he did his job. But doing the best he could, I should imagine, gauging from his report every year. And at the end of the 6 years, we tried to look back and say, what did he do? And he did quite a lot, as many of the friends and your guests have testified. But after that, it was so self-effacing. He just stepped down quietly. And therefore, I think this is a very elegant person with an elegant upbringing to have put himself center stage, at the center, front, back, observe it. But in the end, when the term is over, and there is no power hunger, there is no hunger for more power, there is no hunger for anything more, no? And I think this is the essence of the servant leader, as probably his school had taught him. We serve the best we can, but when the time comes, then we say it's a time for everyone else to come in. And during his time, he did try to get everyone on board. I was saying that earlier. everyone has a role to play in governance. He was an instrument, but by and large, it was private sector, it was community, the bottom-up approach of planning, of local governance. You know, it was not really strong from the top alone, no, but it's really bringing everyone in.
I also want to take a moment now to also put the spotlight on how he looked at women as leaders. He was raised by a very strong woman, and in his cabinet there were a lot of women, and the way he also supported women empowerment throughout his governance. What can you tell us more about that?
Well, actually, my reading is that his personal life, I mean, a person who's practically surrounded by strong women, the mother, the sisters, no? All the sisters reflected and, you know, somehow probably shaped the kind of leader that he was, that he had time to listen to women and that there were women in the leadership during his administration. A very strong Philippine Council Commission on Women, and really nurtured the role of these women leaders. Probably around him were very, very strong women leaders. And he never felt insecure about it, because that's the character of someone who is secure by himself, and he would want to share power and want to share leadership, regardless of the gender.
Earlier on, I was talking to Brother Armin Luistra, and he did say that, you know, politics got in the way. When you talk about the accomplishments of the Aquino administration, imperfect as that administration was, you cannot erase the gains, but somehow politics got in the way. What can you tell us about how politics and governance seem to be interchangeable in the Philippine context, even if both should be vastly different from each other?
Well, actually, there is a relationship between politics and governance. From the academic point of view, governance is first and foremost shaped by a political exercise, such as an election. It is a political choice. It is a political alignment of those who would want to offer themselves for public service. So to a certain extent, we cannot detach politics from governance. But the thing is, over and above anything else, governance is supreme in the sense that when one has taken the political authority and the political power, what comes into play now would be a sensible way of managing and running the affairs of society. I mean, it's not just running the affairs of government, but it's also running the affairs of the public, meaning how one listens to community, how one listens to Congress, how one listens to external stakeholders. This is governance. And in each of this, listening to one sector or one group has a tinge of politics. I mean, when one doesn't listen and one is not open to a kind of hearing what other sectors want to say, I think this is where we need the political ears, Carmina. So to me, there is a connection between politics and governance. But at the end of the day, we say political interest is there to serve the bigger goal, which is for the intention, for the good of society, for the good of the bigger community, and for the good of all. And this is where governance becomes supreme in the end. When one sits in a position of power, such as Malacanang, one has to sort of trim politics a bit and say, I'd like to politics which is one-sided, but I'd like to listen to everyone now. And that's governance. Participation is governance. Listening to every sector, or especially those who we need to serve, no? So I think it's a very flimsy a delineation between politics and governance, but one is a smart leader and one is a smart governor when one knows what to do when one is holding on to a position of power already.
And when you talk about the former president, when he was given that political power in 2010, how would you define, very briefly, how would you define how he made use of that political power?
I think in the end, he was looking at the bigger picture of how he would like to do his service. So he brought everyone on board as much as he can, as best he can. It wasn't perfect. It wasn't entirely 100% probably agreeable to everybody. But I think the best he could, he served. And he brought, he tried to listen to different groups and to different sectors. Mm. And to me, that kind of leader is what would be called a servant leader, but also in the definition of governance, I think that's the style of a 21st century governance.
Professor Edna Co, I appreciate you always giving your insights to us, sharing any insights you may have with us. Thank you so much for joining us today. Continue to take care and keep safe. And again, hope to talk to you during happier times.
Yes, thank you.